Before we march ahead and we invite our next speaker over here, let us have our partner AVs, please. All right. Before we have our partner AVs, we have one more chance. One more person can win iPhone 10. And I have another question over here. So everybody, back to your Twitter accounts. And the question is, name two new feature launches for India in the last 3 months. The options are dynamic search ads and Bing shopping campaigns, action extension and responsive search ads, image extension and LinkedIn profile targeting. We have the three options. The question is here. Everyone, please use the hashtag TechMunch. Along with that, the handle Zarka Digital and MSF Advertising. And the first one gets a chance to win iPhone 10 once again. I'm just going to take a few seconds while people are tweeting over here. All right, well, all the very best, and let's now move ahead to our next panel discussion. It's a very interesting digital marketing panel discussion on digital marketing, then, now, and next. Let me first invite the session chair. Please put your hands together as I welcome Jayraj, Jadhav, Vice President, Head Marketing and Digital Business, TataAIG General Insurance. Come on, everyone, little louder, please. Welcome, sir. I would now like to invite our panelists over here. Mangesh, Panditrao, CEO, Shoptimize. Joining them, we have Nipun, Kaushal, CMO, PNB, Metlife. Pallav, Jain, CEO, Performics India. Join the panelists, we have Sachin, Killawala, Director, Marketing, Nivea. Along with them, Mr. Sanjay Mehta, joined CEO, Mirum India. Shamsuddin, Jasani, Group MD, South Asia, Isobar. And Mr. Vivek Sharma, CMO, Pidilite. Let's hear it for everyone over here, all the dignitaries over here. And the topic for this panel discussion is digital marketing, then, now, and next.
Hi everyone. I think it's one of the best topic to be discussed, as probably Sham said, collage or cull for the digital media. And I got one of the best panel mix to discuss this topic. Right from content performance, technology, to the agencies that have pioneered some of this work in India, to brands representing right from financial services, FMCG, to Pidilite, which is into multiple product categories for us. So I think if you look at this whole journey about digital marketing, and fortunate to kind of lived part of it myself, you know, the biggest change that has happened over the period, and I'll not dwell too much into the past, but, you know, I think I still remember, you know, the standard, you know, if in one line, if I have to sum up this whole journey, it is typically, you know, started from, you know, what are you doing in digital to what else can be done on digital? You know, that's a change, that's a big shift of a question that I received today versus yesterday. You know, that's how the digital has kind of evolved and, you know, and has kind of, you know, gained the center stage in most of the discussions in the organization in today's day. So if you look at, I think, some of the key parameters that probably changed, you know, in this last 5 years and probably would shape up next few years for digital would be, you know, the technology, like, you know, emergence of data and probably fine-tuning of performance from that perspective. And then also looking at how a right brain, which is your creative, can play, creative content can play an effective role in digital. I think I'll keep forum open to kind of understand, you know, how each one of them see this journey for them in last 5 years. What are the key, probably, you know, key areas that you see are very important from a change perspective? We can probably start from Sham.
Okay. First of all, thank you guys for coming here. Second of all, apologies that you only see men here. So I think that's another thing that we need to kind of change. So that's a aaj ka issue. And I think that's a very important that kal we don't see this. So starting from there, I think where we used to be, and as the idea of this panel is not to dwell on what happened in the past. It's about looking in today and into the future as we go forward. I think the whole word digital is slowly kind of disappearing, I would say, from the language of a lot of marketers today. The lines are blurring. What is traditional media? What is digital media? I think we ourselves actually, as Isobar, no longer call ourselves as a digital agency. Yes, kal hum log, yesterday we were a digital agency. Today we are the agency for the digital age, as we call it. Increasingly, clients and our partners, I would put it, are turning to us to give them solutions which not necessarily are only digital, but are digital first. So let me put it that way. They are digital first solutions, which was not there in the past. In the past, we were just an agency which would kind of take what was done already on traditional and then add a little bit on digital and then take it from there, from more of an execution agency. I think that's changed a lot, and I think that today and the tomorrow is where, and the tomorrow rather, is where we as a partner, and I, again, not calling it an agency, can work with a client to use digital to transform their businesses and not really just look at where advertising or marketing is really happening, because that's really the difference which digital brings. A television is a medium for communication. Digital is not just a medium for communication. It's not just for information dissemination or getting leads or getting you know, your products sold. It is also a way that you can conduct your business or change your business. And that's really, I think, in a very small nutshell, what I would like to say, where we are and where we are going into the future.
I think probably same question, if you can answer about, you know, what are the key parameters that you see are very critical from a future, you know, next 5 years, or, you know, what are the things that you see that are going to define, you know, next 5 years of the digital media? You know, we've seen, you know, probably a shift from, as you mentioned, you know, probably pure performance lead, or, you know, digital was always about, you know, how, you know, what's the kind of, you know, performance that you're getting out of that, versus I see a lot of change that is happening from digital being part of your business now. So what do you think, you know, how is this shaping up?
So at the outset, you know, continuing the thought that Shams started with, that it's not exclusively digital and mainline, et cetera, anymore. And one of the reasons contributing to that also is the fact that consumption of content is happening increasingly on a digital device. So the traditional form of content, which was say television or print. You know, more newspapers probably are read on a phone or a tablet. More television content is consumed through maybe your YouTube or a Netflix kind of a channel or OTT channel. So finally, the consumption is happening on a device which is a digital device and which has then an ability to, you know, have data being captured about the consumption, about the consumer who is consuming the content, about the habits, about the other interests that that consumer has, and which is why there is increasing amount of learning or data mining that we are doing about that consumption, which was perhaps not that much possible when it was being consumed more traditionally, when television was seen in a, you know, on a box, or when newspapers were actually largely consumed on paper. Now all that plus digital only content, which is also being there and being consumed, and of course the transaction engines and the e-commerce and the you know variety of fintech products which consumers are increasingly engaging and consuming, that makes it largely a digital powered world. But hence, from an agency perspective, or let's say that distinction of digital, non-digital, I think those things are not relevant anymore, because finally the end delivery is happening increasingly on a digital device. Having said that, you know, we've swung a long way. So when early days of digital, when we go back to the cull or the yesterday, digital started out being an afterthought. It was still largely a mainline or a, you know, traditional creative driven marketing world. And you know, if budgets are left to some extent, a little bit of digital happens. So definitely a huge onus or ownership of performance for the brand in terms of whatever goal that they were trying to achieve lay on the traditional medium or the creative agency. From there, certainly, you know, people discovered digital and leads and performance, and also in some sense the pendulum started swinging the other way. And now again there is a realization that without creative, the performance is not really going to, you know, by itself be sufficient or adequate. So we're again sensing that the two need to work together, but now I think on sort of an equal footing, that a good creative ideation or understanding or expression combined with the right usage of creativity and technology on a digital platform is what's going to deliver the best results for the brand. And that's where I think we are headed in terms of the future.
I think Sachin and Vivek probably, you know, traditionally, both Pidilite and Nivea have been, you know, very heavy on, you know, mainline media, storytelling. How are your brands kind of adopting digital as a media from that perspective? What do you think is a shift that is happening? How are you kind of looking at, you know, kind of digital becoming, or digital media playing an important role in your brand? Is this what is happening, or and how is that taking, you know, taking shape for you?
So I think as Shamsuddin rightly mentioned, that we are no longer a digital marketing agency, but they are in the digital age of marketing. And to me, that's a very interesting point, because if you go back, how many of you here remember the first TV ad? The first TV ad. Can you please raise your hand? Which was the first TV ad? Wait, what was it? No. Globally, not India. Globally, the first TV ad. The first TV ad was a watch ad. It was a clock. A watch ad, and it is quite interesting. You can go to YouTube and type the first TV ad. It was essentially a radio ad with a picture of a clock. So for 10 seconds, there's a clock, static picture of a clock, and somebody saying, you know, here is the best clock in the world, please buy it. That's it. Right? And it's quite an interesting learning over there, that when TV was launched, the TV age was launched with it. And initially, everybody treated TV like radio. And it took us quite many years to actually come to this creative storytelling 30-second format with a certain media strategy, reach, frequency approach to arrive at a science from a FMCG business point of view, that if you invest it in a certain way, you create demand, and that's how you kind of make money as a business. In the digital age, this formula doesn't hold true. So we need to figure out not just good creative ideas. I think creative idea storytelling per se remains the same. That's not going to change. But what is going to change is the way we tell the story, the medium in which we tell the story. All our comfort zones, I can confirm as a client, are completely being broken. We are very comfortable with a 30-second TVC ad. We are very comfortable with a print ad. We are very, very comfortable doing outstanding scientific media planning. But we are not very comfortable buying on a YouTube. Or we are not very comfortable creating a long-form, 5-second, do-it-yourself tutorial. We are not. Right? But this is the age which is coming to. It's no longer that the consumer is a sitting duck and you kind of make your masterpiece and show it to them. The consumer will pretty much decide whether they like what you're telling them or not like what you're telling them. So I think overall it's become much more easier for the consumer, but much, much more difficult as a marketer to take on this challenge.
So just like to add a few things. So I run Shoptimize, which is an e-commerce platform, and we run marketing with it. You know, just to start with the first question, the journey that we've seen is the journey towards credibility. I mean, digital marketing, at least when we started, wasn't very credible. We weren't able to attribute a lot of success to it, and that has completely changed in the past few years. It is, again, the digital age, and we are marketing in the digital age. But just one thing to add to what Sachin said is what we are also seeing is the era of personalization, right? So the era to tell one story in multiple ways or multiple stories to multiple audiences, multiple languages, and that's what digital lets you do over and above the reach and the mind share that it gets. It lets you personalize that message. And we've seen some phenomenal results when we've really gone down that road, including language. So that's just something to add.
Yeah. See, I will talk about digital from a business perspective. Digital, which once started as, are we doing digital also, it has moved to now, digital is an essential part of the business. And in boardroom, everyone loves digital. You know why? Because it's measurable. It has been sold on measurability. Now what we have observed and experienced as a traditional consumer and B2B marketing goods company is that digital, as Shams rightly said, the boundaries are completely gone. And I'll illustrate my what I'm saying with examples. On one hand, digital can be only for performance marketing, can generate business. On other hand, TV and mass media was supposed to create brands and only brand building. But now digital can do both interchangeably. So if you take a brand like Dr. Fixit, which is a waterproofing brand, of course it's sold through retail counters, it's sold through contractors, but we are very active in performance marketing in digital, and we generate a substantial part of our business. So I can't quote the number, but a very substantial part of our business through digital. 70% of our leads which come to us, which are non-retail, are from digital medium. And the conversion rates are very, very high. Now, does it mean that we are not building the brand in a traditional medium? We are doing that. So performance marketing is very important. But here, it's a multimedia approach. I'll give you one more approach without taking a name. We have a household product which we are test marketing in one city, which is Pune. It is only digital approach. So we have taken a city called Pune. We are going to do a digital campaign which will lead consumers to fulfill through e-commerce, Amazon, as well as modern trade. We are tying up with modern trade people. And that's an experiment. We will see what we will do in that. There are separate creatives for that. And we are doing stuff there which is not possible in traditional medium. If a product has 8 to 10 uses, you can't tell their story in television or print. But in digital medium, you can actually do it very, very well. To a woman, I can show some other uses. So men, I can show some other uses. The third part is you may have Fevicol. I think everyone has heard. Now, Fevicol business is not generated through digital. But brand building happened through TV, but nowadays brand building is equally happening through digital. I'll give you some examples. Because we're having the discussion with Shams about brand building, and I said, look, brand building can also be done beautifully and in a very, very fascinating way on digital only. Because when I joined Pidilite, we said, look, Fevicol appeals to all of us who have grown on the TV ads. But what about 25 to 30-year-old who are going to make a furniture, set up a house 5 years from now when they're going to be 30? Will they be as much in love with the brand as we are? The answer was perhaps not, because we are not talking to them. There are many youngsters I see in my office who don't watch TV. They are on OTT platforms. So how do we reach these people? So Fevicol started actively participating on social media platforms, and it actively reached out. And the proof of the pudding is that it's ranking amongst 18 to 25, rose up from rank 8 amongst household brands to rank 3 last year. So we are appealing to those people. In other ways, when people make furniture, they look for designs. Earlier, they used to find furniture books. Nowadays, everyone goes to Google and start looking for furniture designs. So there we created a platform called, we have our own FDI, furniture designs idea, FDI, where we give ideas to young generation on furnitures. That's a one way of brand engagement. Now in both these examples, we are not doing any sales at all. We're only building brand. In Dr. Fixit, we are doing brand building and performance marketing both. In the second example I gave you of a test marketing, we're only doing digital. So digital has come a long way, and I think the boundary is truly, truly blurred. But I think as a practitioner where we handle multimedia brand, one thing we should actually discuss is attribution, because it's good to spend X amount of money on digital, but then you say how much of it is leading to brand building, how much of it is actually leading to only business generation, that attribution is not very easy. And if I can just mention one more thing about future, I think a lot of us here are talking about platforms, mediums, advertising, impressions, acquisitions, that's fine. There are perhaps many businesses which are built only on digital. But in future, it's going to be more about CRM and analytics, because I'll give another example. We have a huge database of our contractors who have with us or consumers who have with us. Now we will start targeting them again with specific mediums to generate business. And I think digital has to go in MarTech more from AdTech. That is the key thing. And I think we must work together as a group and industry to develop common mediums of measurement. And that's something I think we can further discuss.
Okay. I think coming back to Pallav, I think, and you rightly touched upon the fact that, you know, the measurement and MarTech, I think, are one of the key areas that kind of shaped up last few years of digital, and hopefully kind of, you know, will be one of the key areas for the next next few years for digital media shape up, right? So I think, do you see any trend coming up on the MarTech side where, you know, there are so many players kind of, you know, manage, and so many tools possibly there for marketers to kind of choose? Probably skill set is one of the area which agencies must have seen as a shift, right? Because a lot of it was earlier managed by many people, yes, which can be now managed by technology. Right. So do you see that, you know, that shift will be critical?
Significantly. Yeah. Significantly, right? So I wanted to cover a few points, you know, with regard to some of the points that some of the esteemed panelists have made. In terms of how, you know, the digital marketing has evolved in general, and then go on to the points in terms of how it is impacting the way we do business. And this will be more laced from a perspective of an agency, a performance marketing agency that I lead currently, right? So the first point over there, taking on from what Shams mentioned and what Sunil mentioned, what Vivek mentioned earlier as well, is that the differentiation, not just in terms of offline and online, is blurring in some ways. Of course, the biggest way of, you know, bridging this gap is going to be in terms of getting that one unified currency on which work is already happening in different industry forums. But what I've seen very significantly is that the gap between you know, the traditional way of planning on digital as a medium, wherein branding plans would be made differently, performance plans would be made differently, is already extinguished, right? A lot of brands that we work with now work from the perspective of driving business as an objective, but work with an integrated plan. So the difference in branding and planning and performance from that perspective is totally blurred, totally driven by the ad tech and the advances that have been made in terms of attribution techniques, the advent of programmatic, the advent of you know, ad serving and evolution over there altogether. Add to that and top it up with sophisticated multi-touch attribution models that are available purely for digital, I think it gives a whole new dimension and a whole new amount of measurability, you know, to this entire piece over here, right? We work with a lot of banks. Surprisingly speaking, the skew of the bank spends earlier, which used to be very, very driven on performance marketing, has changed significantly now to a branding plus performance, where branding is also leading to performance, and that is being measured very, very precisely, right? So that's one key difference that has come. The second point that you mentioned over here, that you know, there's a seismic shift in the way plans were made and plans are being executed as well currently, right? And therefore, what does that entail for agencies and client digital teams both, in terms of you know, the team structure, the skill sets, etc. Right? Platforms such as Google, Facebook, the programmatic platforms, even the MarTech platforms, are all increasingly powered by ML and AI algorithms, and the amount of physical effort required or the amount of manual work required to actually run campaigns has reduced significantly, right? So much so that it has led to a shift in the way in which agencies are contributing to clients. Of course, the evolution has to be in tandem with the client. It can't just happen only at the agency's end, right? So we're driving that with different levels, with different partners at this point of time, depending on their evolution as well. We're working with them on that. But I see increasingly that in the next one and a half years, the amount of people dedicated to execution and just planning on these platforms will change. It'll come down. And the role of creative, because digital has enabled the way, has paved the way actually of building dynamic creatives in a very cost-efficient manner and at scale as well. The input of the agency is going to be more towards influencing how creatives are shaping the overall performance of the campaign, not just on branding and engagement metrics, but also on performance metrics. It's already happened to a great extent in the app economy. And then the next step of that would be in terms of analytics and data science altogether, right? So like you rightly pointed, the next wave over here is going to be in terms of bringing CRM and analytics together. The current challenge that most organizations and legacy organizations face at this point of time is that data is stored in disparate sources. The CRM system is different. Digital data is captured in web analytics and on your ad servers. Your enterprise SAP systems are altogether different. Nothing is talking to each other. And therefore, the utilization of platforms platforms such as probably Google Cloud or AWS, which become the baseline for actually marrying all of these together, making that one identifier, funneling this through sophisticated data science and analytics platforms, and then eventually running acquisition campaigns as well as engagement campaigns for that. I think that's the future. People, you know, advertisers and agencies who are able to crack that, I think are going to have a significant edge above anybody else who's not been able to do that. So it's a very backward momentum that's coming, and you have consulting agencies or consulting organizations who are now trying to get into execution, media, etc. And that's one level of disruption. There are agencies who are trying to backward integrate into being more intelligent, become more valuable partner. You know, in the vein of what Shams said, digital being the way of business rather than just a channel of driving business.
Right? Yeah, I think interesting point. I think one of the key shift that I really see, is also the lines becoming very thin between technology companies, agencies, consultant, and also client. You know, I see a lot of things which earlier used to be what agencies will do probably are moving to clients, managing them internally on their own. There are probably some, the digital marketing is no more just a media, probably it's also a large amount of investment on technology, so technology companies make equally important decision. I think, Nipun, from that perspective, we've seen like in financial service, especially in insurance, it's always been, well-connected, orchestrated effort between a digital marketing CRM and probably, business. So how do you see this kind of shaping up?
So, okay, if we just step back a few years, but I'm saying few years, maybe two decades back. So fortunately at that time, with being with auto sector at that time, we saw what I would say we all panelists remember those times when having a website itself meant you are digital. So if you have a website, you have launched a new car, you must have a website which one agency person will make, and you say it's available there, and that's the end of it. Then slowly the process came up, Google became more advanced. You today have more than 1800 million websites. And Google also became smarter in making it more targeted, so then the concepts of ROPO and other things and showrooming started happening. Now, if I step on to the other side, one is saying digital, other is saying digitization. So what Jayraj, you are saying from insurance standpoint, where there is not a tangible product to be felt, insurance is a push product. Unfortunately, till now it's been a push product until unless it's mandated. When that's the case, for a digital marketing team or the digital agency, it's largely about ROI. And to take a few examples, large insurance companies are largely backed by larger brands, the mother brand. So the for a digital marketer, it's more important to see how much do I want to spend to build the brand, because you have a mother brand operating. But at the same time, how can I provide service to the customer? Now, I might do all my performance-based campaigns to drive acquisition, but end of the day, fulfillment also has to happen digitally, because there is no physical product being given. Now, in that scenario, digitization plays more important, and somewhere I would say over the journeys, where there were silos between the within the organization, operations, IT, and things, that has started mixing up together. Now, there is nothing called as, you know, operations has got nothing to do with the digital team or the digitization. So somewhere, I also see the future, a lot of the CTOs, the chief digital officers, actually formulating plans on how to reach out to the customer and what are the back-end services to be provided. So I think the way forward from financial standpoint, even say for example, a journal insurance on travel, there is no physical document. I mean, I get standing at the airport, I can do it. So you can push the horse to the water, but to make him drink is your other departments which are working behind it. So from digital agency standpoint, I think the shift that I've seen when we operate with our agencies, they understand the back-end process much better now. So rather than just saying brand building, performance, lead generation, they are conscious on COA, they are conscious on retention, and how do I retain those customers through my digital initiatives? I think that's the most critical piece now where we are moving.
So I think we covered technology in a bit. We looked at how the journey has happened. I think I'll have a couple of points which I just want to kind of understand panel's view. I think one big shift that I clearly also see, but not many successes, also regional language playing an important role. So how is it, you know, is that really a big area? Do you see early success on the same from FMCG perspective? How does it work for you?
Yeah, I mean, from our point of view, regional is quite massive and is actually a core part of our strategy. And again, it's quite logical. If you think about it, when we were doing TV ads, we used to do 9 languages, 10 languages, right? So we were doing it. It's not just because digital is English, suddenly it becomes much more easier to, you know, for creative to be approved in English and all. No, so, and it's not easy. I mean, while I say it, I mean, I just spotted some of my agency partners here. It is a challenge, right, to get creative writers, you know, to think the same language. Also to get feedback, because then the comments are in the regional language. How do you assess those comments? It is the way to go forward. There's no going back on that topic. Digital is about, digital age is about trying to get as closer to the consumer as possible. So you're talking about the insurance business. I actually just read a very interesting case study. How many of you know about Lemonade? Do you know of Lemonade, right?
Yeah.
It's fascinating how they've just crashed the entire business. The entire insurance process, start to end, is on an app. With instant approvals, instant payback money, it is fascinating what they're doing to the business. So, you know, when you get closer to the consumer and start solving real problems of the consumer, then whether it is a language, whether it is a tech piece, whether it is a problem with the consumer is having silos, firewalls, I think all will disappear. And the way we address not just the marketing piece, also the way we do business, like you rightly mentioned, your silos are, you know, completely being demolished, is completely going to change. It is scary, but at the same time, it is super exciting, right? Because we are entering a completely new way of doing business.
So just a few experiments we ran on language, which I would like to share. So one of the things we did for one of our customers was we ran banners or customized the website, and a lot of the banners to Bengali in Bengal. We did the same thing in Andhra for Telugu. And we found that English converted better in West Bengal than Bengali. And Telugu converted better, you know, in Andhra. So not just the fact that you can customize one language, but also it's become a lot more measurable now. It's of course a factor of the audience that was there, et cetera, et cetera. So we are seeing this impact conversion ratios. We are seeing this impact, you know, time spent on site, multiple things. And you don't really need to change everything because you need to balance the effort to localize or to change the language versus the returns you get. So key things that generate emotion can be in multiple languages, and prices and names of products can continue in English. I think we found a good balance there, at least with the customers we work with.
Just probably one more question here is, do you also see the shift of, you know, probably the way teams are structured or team composition from that perspective? You mentioned about being, you know, having a younger team to kind of manage certain aspect. Do you also see the mix changing? Like, you know, a lot of, you know, I've seen in the insurance industry, you know, there are companies, new age companies, or even at our own company, you know, we've seen like a lot of tech. Like the composition is shifting from, you know, pure marketeers to, you know, technology plus marketeer kind of thing. And it's largely IT company with marketing angle to it kind of a scenario. So do you see this kind of, you know, moving ahead from here?
See, we are not a technology company, so we don't have that much specialization, but I think, of course, you need younger people in digital market. You need your teams who can think digital much more than people like me. You need your agencies who is full of young people who think digital all the time. See, if you see, take an extreme example. You see a rickshawala, you see a carpenter, they have a phone in their hand. That phone is a digital device. It's part of their life, it's a part of their body. They don't think, I am doing digital now or not. Similarly, we also need to start thinking digital is not something separate. But yes, it needs certain skills and understanding, and I think sooner we imbibe it is better it is. Of course, there need to be specialists we need to hire in analytics or CRM, data management. I think you rightly pointed out that you have marketers have to collaborate with far more people in the organization to make digital work. So first collaboration is with IT, because the data in silos have to speak to each other. Then you have to make sure that the offline and the online is integrated, because the expectation levels because of digitization has actually gone up for consumers. The response time, the turnaround times, what they expect is the same in offline. No, now in digital, in app, you have fantastic turnaround time, but the same person goes to your shop or goes to your service center, he expects the same thing. So marketer has to make sure that the integration, the mindset has to change everywhere in digital marketing. I think to your previous question, I'd just like to add one thing in creative part. It's a very obvious thing, but I think people won't like to admit, but let me say it. I think still as an industry, we're in love with the television commercials and TV commercials. We love our TVCs and print ads. And how often do we see the same stuff going in digital? I think that is not the way, because when we are targeting consumers at different stages of understanding, aware, not aware, or tried your product or not, you have to give them different messages. And we have learned it the hard way in Dr. Fix it. Now we have customized messages, that's one. Second is how fashionably we like to do influencer marketing. It's very easy to do. But I have seen actually all influencers on the same day on Twitter giving the same lines. It's a cut paste from a PR release. And you start laughing saying, what is everyone doing? So I think it's good to use digital marketing, which is right, but in a moderate fashion, knowing very well that the old age of PR release and old age of putting your print ad and TVCs in digital is gone. So that's not the way. I think that's one point I want to mention here.
So if I may add to the question on the team, but I think in the context of the team, I'll just go back a step to the technology part as well. I think when we think in terms of, you know, we've talked about MarTech and, you know, specifically also personalization, I think the core to a marketing program is going to be increasingly a marketing automation engine. And if you think in terms of marketing automation, it's what is it? I mean, it's essentially four components to it. There is a data collection component. We've talked about data coming from multiple sources, bringing it together, unifying the data at one point. So that's the data collection part. Then getting an actionable view to the data. So you've got data, now what do you want to do with it? So, you know, essentially different kinds of cuts to the data that you get. then creating a decision engine. The decision engine could be in the form of a journey builder, an audience builder, whatever it is. That how are you mapping the data from a decision making point? And finally, it's the activation, where you actually do an email campaign or a, you know, ad studio or email studio, whatever are the elements of your action activation engine. So those are the elements of a marketing automation program. Now, what that what it also aligns today increasingly when you're doing this are what we now start referring to as an agile form of marketing. When you're doing this, you're building short journeys, quick campaigns, quick measurability, because you're running a particular journey from a marketing automation point of view. You've created certain hypotheses, you're putting it out, you have very clear, measurable goals, and you'll be able to see a turn and see whether you shifted the numbers or you moved the needle or not. When you have agile marketing, you have a lot of sprints running in the marketing cycle. Now, when you have sprints, you need to be able to understand the impact of the sprint. So here is where we now get to the team point of view. It's not just about having digital folks, but you have folks who are on the execution perspective, and there are folks who are on the analyzing point of view. And there are two different mindsets of people. The resource, the person who can just do measurement is not your right person who can actually analyze and interpret and tell you what's next. And in an agile marketing, you need that an understanding of the results to decide whether you need to tweak the campaign further, you need to change the journey, you need to make any changes in your marketing automation program. And that's when you start deriving the big bang for the buck. So it's involving various things: a MarTech solution, data collection, unifying data, decision engine, et cetera, et cetera. But along with it, smart, agile marketing, which requires a separate data collection person, a separate analyst, at every level, people who have a different mindset are required to really execute this program efficiently.
So just one thing I would like to add to that, because the volume of data and the amount of analysis that needs to happen, we found machine learning actually help us a lot more there. We can't possibly have enough people to analyze the amount of data that's being generated. We use things like reinforcement learning, we use different algorithms to reduce that problem size significantly so that a few humans can make decisions on it. So that's to add to the rest of the team.
I'll just one point probably. We've been talking about data measurement. Just one probably question around the same. You know, a lot of us, it is clearly coming out as digital is becoming part of our business and business objectives, right? And we also have our own data, our own measurement. Do you see a common currency or a common, centrally kind of a body that can talk about, data that becomes a reality, or it just probably will never work for digital? Because, see, in digital, it's just the way it is personalization to the customer, it's also personalization to the business, right? So every business objectives and campaigns work separately. We have our own data, we can analyze our own data. Do you see, common currency or common metrics becoming a reality ever?
So it's tricky on digital. For everyone out here, we as a industry are working very hard to bring this. You pretty much know what happened with Bark and Ecom. I think pretty much the entire industry knows. It's not that easy. It's very difficult to have a single measurement for digital, because Facebook says that I am a very different kind of an environment. Was YouTube says I'm very different. Our star will say my measurement is very different. A 1 second review or 2 second review or 7 second review, a banner versus a video versus a click versus an impression. So there are so many different kinds of ways to actually track and measure. But we are working very hard to bring in a more systematized measurement system, which in India we will standardize as this is across many bodies that we are working on. And hopefully in the next year or so, we should have this ready for, and the buy-in will be with all the stakeholders. It will not just be for one or two stakeholders. All the main stakeholders need to have a buy-in. The two major stakeholders in India who have a big say in it are, of course, Google and Facebook. They have very big say in measurability. Globally, they have very big say in measurability. But we are working very hard to make sure that there is a single or an easier not single, but an easier way, an easier currency to measure what's happening. That's number one on digital itself. Number two is cross-media. I think the major step for cross-media will happen when TV moves from DTH to through the pipe on internet. And I think with the advent in the next 6 months of Geo2 revolution, as I call it, that's going to become a reality which is much closer to home, because your TV will also be delivered through the internet pipe. That means that you will be able to now actually be able to do a cross-device much in a much easier manner, because right now the technologies are very different. But once it sits on the same kind of a technology where you have, I think Reliance is coming up at $600 all channels. So wait for that revolution, and the television will no longer be traditional, it'll be digital. But that's going to be the big revolution. So another 2 to 3 years, I see cross-media also becoming a very easier reality than right now that it is. So I think that's another thing that's going to happen.
Stepping back to your previous question on vernacular. So from insurance industry standpoint, or rather many other industries, we say India lies in the rural, but rural is equally aware of the technology. They prefer in their specific language, and we realized when we plan to do for our agent recruitment in their specific language, the response rates are much better. Second part is the profile of the digital marketer changing. I think it's more than a digital marketer. I think it's going to be more of a business partner, a digitally enabled business partner. So the person has to understand every leg of it and has to be innovatively creative going forward. And lastly, on data, data is required. We'll have a single source of data, whether it is from the rural or the pipe, but one got to be careful you don't get into data paralysis and, you know, miss out on the maize bus. So I think that's something that I would say.
I think just 1 30-second on the regional language part. I think what we have not touched upon, interestingly, in a panel of this kind, is the impact of voice. And the interesting thing is that on the regional language in particular, the largest area where voice is being used is in tier 2, tier 3 in regional language. And I think that's an area where brands are, I suspect, least prepared at this point amongst everything else. A lot of things we're trying to sort of get the brands up to speed, but being available in a voice search, responding adequately, especially in regional languages, catering to the tier 2, tier 3 audience, I think that's a huge challenge right now.
I'm so sorry to interrupt, but we're running out of time now.
For questions or?
No, we don't have time for the questions. I'm so sorry.
Thanks, guys. I think it was interesting discussion. I think we covered probably technology that would kind of shape up next 5 years for digital. We kind of discuss about data as well as probably regional language, which will come into play. More important aspect, I guess, is digital becoming mainline and not really, and it's part of the business. It's no more just a media. That's, I think, what is a critical outcome of the discussion, I guess. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you so much to all the panelists and moderator. Let's hear it for them, everyone. I would request you to be with us for a couple of more seconds, and I would like to invite Bhavna Sencher, Vice President Revenue Zapper, to please join us to present the token of gratitude to all the panelists and moderator over here. We have a group photograph. Yeah. I would request you, ma'am, to join them, yes, for a group picture.